In our current sermon series, Cultivating a Culture Beyond Ourselves, we explore all dimensions of our relationships in the world as Christ teaches us to look after the things that concern others more than our own. Today, we'll address a part of our Christian life that we seldom talk about, and that is our relationship with the governing authorities. In Romans chapter 12, the Apostle Paul puts an emphasis on the Christian's relationship with other people, both within the church, as in our relationship with fellow believers of Christ, and then with everyone else. Here in the first part of Romans 13, particularly in verses 1-7, the Apostle Paul extends that discussion within the realm of civic authorities. That means world governments who are in charge of keeping the rule of civic law and social justice. What is expected from a follower of Christ when it comes to their relationship with the governments of the world for which they are citizens of? What does the Christian's personal relationship with Christ have to do with their responsibility to these governments? And what if the Christian's obedience to those who are in authority come into conflict with their obedience to God? The answers are not simple, so we look to God's word for wisdom. The current pandemic has significantly exposed this issue more than ever, as the body of Christ wrestles with these very questions. Much of this conflict with government seems to stem from the view that some churches have that the government should not impede on their God-given right and responsibility to gather in person, which comes into conflict with the government's mandate to keep everyone safe by restricting physical gatherings that can lead to a surge of infections. This discord between the church and the state has for long been controversial because historically the relationship between the two hasn't been cordial. Some churches have become suspicious of government institutions, which lead many to question their authority. Governments unfortunately feel the same way at times about the church. Some churches then begin to question whether the government is in line with God's mandate. And when they see the disparity, those churches decide to refuse and even rebel against such authority. This hostility between the two has reached the headlines on more than one occasion during this pandemic and throughout history, when some churches will openly reject and disobey the directive of the government, and with governments themselves taking action against such churches. Who would you say is in the right here? Is it that easy to tell? The Bible has shown the reality of this tension on many occasions, and in those occasions, the outcome tends to vary. However, as Paul and even others who faithfully follow God across the long history of the Bible, they conclude that obedience to government is part of our obedience to God. For the most part, we'll explore the exceptions later down the sermon. But this is the big idea that we would like to pursue today, based on the passage we are coming across in Romans 13. We look at the example in this instance, right? But we'll deal with that later. The other side of the reality is we as followers of Christ may and will be placed in certain situations where we will have to choose which authority we must obey. It is happening more than ever, and this speaks a lot more on how the world is turning out to be as the Bible has prophesied. Paul's teaching in this passage is even made more powerful when you consider what the government and the social environment he lived in was like in his time and even in the time of Christ. So let's talk about that briefly. So you know that the command Paul issues here is not without its challenge and controversy. First and foremost, slavery flourished during this time of the rule of the Roman government or empire. It was held that there are three slaves for every free person during this time. It was an age of absolute rulers. The Roman Republic has just ended, so it was no longer a true democracy, but rather an autocracy led by one powerful individual, and that is Caesar. There have been many Caesars throughout the time of the Roman Empire. But Caesar is king in absolute authority. Even with the murder of the famous Caesar by the name of Julius Caesar, in the Roman Senate, that didn't overthrow that absolute rule, but rather seems to have reinforced it. He's the commander-in-chief who stood above all the senators. He was deemed to be a god and demanded that kind of worship and adoration from the Roman citizens for which Israel was under the Roman Empire. Beyond this, Israel was allowed to maintain their own form of government, but was equally, if not more, oppressive. Herod was placed as the king of the Jews, but still very much a proxy to Caesar. These Herods enacted rule without any consequences, as you can recall, even issuing without hesitation the murder of infant males under the age of 2, at the time of Christ's infancy. Their actions come with no repercussions or oppositions. Taxes were heavy, and tax collectors were ruthless, who made money out of this privilege as long as they gave to the Roman Empire what is due to them. This is the kind of government that Paul and all the citizens were living in at the time that Paul wrote his letter to the church in Rome. Do keep these in mind when we consider what Paul calls the Christian to do in their relationship with the government. Furthermore, during this oppressive reign of these governments, many zealous Jews in that day recognized no king but God and paid taxes to no one but God. Hence, being called those feisty group of insurrectionists called the Zealots. The Apostle Paul begins his approach on this controversial topic of his day, particularly with the oppressed Christians, on the rule of government. He explains firsthand the reason for why we need to submit to authorities based on the truth that God is in control. God remains the supreme sovereign above these governments, whether they become good or bad. So then this means that submitting to government is also our way of submitting to God. Let's explore this teaching further. There is an inherent controversy and difficulty in the instruction that Paul starts off with in this part of his letter to the body of Christ in Rome, knowing the kind of government he is asking everyone to submit to. In Romans chapter 13, verse 1, he wrote, "Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God." The command is simple. Submit to the ruling authorities despite their atrocities. But the circumstances and the character of the Roman government that existed in Paul's time makes this complex and challenging. This teaching was hard to fathom for Christians who suffered enormous hardships and violence under these heartless rulers. However, when we take a closer look, Paul doesn't ask for this kind of blind obedience. He issues it knowing that God is in control over these earthly authorities, so we can confidently submit ourselves to them. Since God is the one who put them in their role, he will deal with them as he has been doing throughout history. The Jews of that day may have forgotten how God, in his sovereignty, dealt with kings and rulers in their history to accomplish his will. But the truth remains that none of those who are in authority came into power without God's hands. And we all know the kind of atrocity and injustice Jesus Christ himself suffered under this kind of Roman and Jewish tyrants. Paul, too, was the recipient of the merciless actions by the ruthless Roman Emperor Nero, under whose rule Paul was executed as a martyr, including the Apostle Peter. Nero was rumored to have been the one who ordered the crucifixion of Peter. When the great fire in Rome set the city ablaze, Nero used the incident as an excuse to persecute many Christians, insinuating that they were responsible for the catastrophe. He began impaling them and setting their corpse on fire as a light source throughout the empire. Christians then were treated with such horrific violence, being regarded as threats and traitors to the stability and structure to the empire. And yet the commentator Newell would write, as he reflected on the words left to us by the Lord through the Apostle Paul, these words: remember your Savior suffered under Pontius Pilate, one of the worst Roman governors Judea ever had, and Paul under Nero, the worst Roman emperor, and neither our Lord nor his apostle denied or reviled the authority. Listen to these two remarkable passages from Daniel. In Daniel chapter 2:21, we read, he changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and raises up others. In Daniel chapter 4, verse 32, the Most High is sovereign over all kingdoms on earth and gives them to anyone he wishes. The call to submit to authority is not an entirely new concept or experience to the Jewish people. Their history as a nation has been marked and marred by the rule of both godly and vicious kings and pharaohs, both foreign and domestic. God and his prophets have reminded them time and time again that he remains in control over these authorities, so that when he asks his people to submit to these authorities, he's really asking his people to remain submissive to his own authority. So there should be no issue for God's people to submit to ruling earthly governments, because God has assured them that he is the ultimate authority. Even when these earthly authorities go above and cross the lines of justice and mercy for all. Even Jesus reaffirmed this when Pontius Pilate confronted him about what Pilate can do regarding the accusations thrown against Jesus. In John chapter 19, verse 10, Pilate felt disrespected by Jesus' silence when Pilate questioned Jesus about his identity. Pilate affirmed his authority and said, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" In response, Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above." Jesus doesn't shy away from reasserting who the true sovereign is and the one who is in the real place of power. Paul follows his teaching by saying in Romans chapter 13, verse 2, these words, "Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves." And so it follows that when we do rebel against the authorities that are in rule over us, we are very much in dissension against God. When Paul states that there is no authority apart from what God has established, he's not encouraging sedition, but rather submission. And the way in which we honor God, who out of his sovereign will, for whatever reason, only he can truly explain. It stands to follow that rebellion against earthly authority is a rejection of heavenly authority. Adding to this, God doesn't take lightly any such rebellion. For Paul says here that those who do revolt against the authorities God has placed will be judged as such. And Paul explains why in the next verse. He says here in Romans 13, verse 3, "For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. What Paul seeks for us to understand is that since these earthly authorities get their mandate from God himself, as the one who established them in the first place, they exercise no reservation in enacting justice against those who desecrate the rule of law. So it is in our best interest to abide by such God-ordained authority. In the first few verses where Paul talks about the rule of government that we just looked at, that God has established, Paul now then starts to discuss the role of government in the next set of verses. God intended human government to play a role according to a divine and delegated purpose. When the Apostle Paul in the next few verses talk about the role of government, the action he calls for Christians is to again submit to them, because these governments, these civil authorities, are God's custodians. God had something in mind when he decided what the role of government should be. And one of the strong insights about the role of government was cited by the late and former U.S. President Ronald Reagan. He said, "Government exists to protect us from each other. Where government has gone beyond its limits is in deciding to protect us from ourselves." So without saying it directly, when he said that government exists to protect us from each other, there's an admission there that we all have the potential to selfishly inflict harm against each other, including the infringement of government against its citizens. It is an acknowledgement of our sinful human nature. And in verse 4 of our passage, Paul continues to write, "For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer." In this verse and following, Paul describes government as God's servant for the express purpose of upholding the good for all people by protecting everyone against those who wish to abuse this common good. That's a tricky balance to accomplish, as you know, recently from this pandemic. What is good for one section of society may be bad for another. But that's the inherent challenge of leading citizens of sinful people like us. What Paul is saying here is an affirmation that governments are placed by God to defend the general or common good of all. This social contract or conscience that God has placed in our spirit as human beings, whether we recognize God or not. Twice in verse 4 of this verse we just read, Paul used the word servant. It's the same word that would describe the office of deacons in the church, who are tasked to meet the practical needs of its members. In its role as a servant of God, governments are similarly tasked to defend the good of all according to this agreement. In itself, at its very core, no matter how failed it may be, was also set by God to protect everyone. Paul adds that such civil authorities, as a result, are God's agents of wrath. In other translations, they are called God's avengers. So that should excite our Marvel fans out there. As God's avengers, they are called to bring punishment to those who would violate this social agreement or social conscience or contract that is meant to protect and preserve the common good. The sword that Paul referenced here refers to the idea of capital punishment. The Roman government of his time executes criminals by way of beheading with the sword, a fate that Paul himself suffered. Crucifixion was reserved for the worst criminals of the lowest classes. So that alone gives you perspective on how the Lord Jesus Christ was himself terribly treated. Paul continues in verse 5, "Therefore it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience." Because the role of government is the protection and preservation of the common good of all people, Paul concludes that it is essential that everyone acknowledges and abides by such authority in the face of not only possible penalty or execution of justice, but as a matter of conscience, a word that Paul uses as the innate ability to distinguish between right and wrong. Consciousness of punishment and conscience, upholding right over wrong, are good enough reasons to submit to authorities. The Apostle Peter supports Paul's arguments by way of confirming the need to submit to human or civic authority as a faithful follower of Christ. He deems it to be the Christian's obedience to the Lord himself. God is honored when we honor the authorities he instituted. Peter here recognized the different levels of these authorities that existed in his day, as we talked about earlier. Look at what he wrote in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13 to 14. "Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right." Peter went as far as describing the office of the emperor as the supreme authority, not in a sense that it is above God's authority, but as the highest earthly authority in that day. Peter himself, along with Paul, clarifies the role of the world government as God's agency, sent by him, meaning appointed according to his own choice, to appropriate justice against those who break the law and acknowledge those who observe it. Paul concludes here with a significant statement that would have riled up a lot of the Jewish zealots who were hell-bent on rejecting the idea of paying taxes to a government they consider abhorrent to God. Listen to what he wrote in verse 6. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants. There's that word again, servants, who give their full time to governing. The issue of paying taxes is controversial only because it is the contention of Jews who oppose the Roman rule that Yahweh is the only authority for them. So when Paul writes the reason for paying taxes, it's because human government is set by God as his agent, servant, or minister. It is very godly then to conclude that taxes should be given to God's delegated authority in the world. These taxes support their God-given accountability to govern, a position that God set as their role. This is their full-time calling from God. So it is no issue to Paul that paying taxes is necessary for the earthly authorities to fulfill this God-given role. The two previous thoughts we covered converge on our final point. Our first point discussed about submission to authorities because God is in control, and that is the rule of government. In the role of government, we are called to, again, submit to these authorities because they are God's delegated custodians. So in our final thought for today, the convergence of those two thoughts come together. Knowing God's heart for the rule and role of government in the world, Paul now calls our attention to our responsibility to them, emphasizing the need to submit to authorities because it is commendable to God. The general rule stands in terms of our conscionable responsibility to governments and to everyone for that matter, as Paul says here in our final verse of this passage. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. However, how Christians operate in the secular world can be very challenging because of the duality of our citizenship. We have an earthly and a heavenly one to live by. There's that tension between religion and politics that has caused grief or discomfort for Christians because of the moral direction and decision that governments are taking everywhere. As faithful followers of Christ, we cannot discount or dismiss situations when governments, as human institutions with a divine mission, can cross the line to rebel against God who set them in power, much like our own rebellious action as sinners. As I stated earlier, what Paul calls us to here is not blind submission, but submission in the reality that even governments can break their God-given mandate. Many times in the Bible and in the history of the known world, where human authorities set by God have breached their role as God's agents, and they themselves have disobeyed God in the process. There are numerous instances in the Bible itself when governing authorities cross that line of being God's agent in the world. And in that sense of, instead of protecting lives and the liberties of people, they bring harm and hardship. I'll give you three examples today from both the Old Testament and the New Testament, but there's certainly more in Scripture. In the first example, we have an Egyptian Pharaoh who, overcome by fear of the growing number of the Israelites, a Pharaoh that has become unfriendly to their interests, issued a command to the midwives of his nation to stop the growth of this nation by killing the infant males as soon as they are born. However, in Exodus chapter 1, verse 17, we read, "The midwives, however, feared God and did not do what the king of Egypt had told them to do. They let the boys live." It's a clear example of disobedience, civil disobedience. In the next example, we have one that chronicles the pursuit of a king to be worshipped as a god in all his dominion. And this is King Nebuchadnezzar. The king had a towering gold image made of himself and ordered everyone to bow down before it. Three young godly men of Jewish origin defied that order because they didn't want to defile themselves in their worship of God. In Daniel chapter 3, verse 28, in the last half of part of it, it was Nebuchadnezzar himself who witnessed how God protected them in the face of such disobedience. we hear exactly from the lips of the king. And we read, as King Nebuchadnezzar himself said, they trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own god. Lastly, after being empowered and filled by the Holy Spirit, Peter and John had gone about preaching everywhere they went, beginning in Jerusalem. The Sanhedrin, the ruling religious authority of that day and culture, forbade them to speak of Christ and the gospel. Peter and John did not comply and responded in Acts chapter 4, verse 19, with such conviction as we read. But Peter and John replied, which is right in God's eyes, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges. When governments cross the line and goes against what God has commanded, which has been taking place in our world and even in our nation today of Canada, as we see them promoting ungodly teachings on gender, marriage, and birthrights of innocent infants, among other things, we are called to be vigilant, becoming involved not just in these matters, but to be prayerful and watchful. Prayer prepares us to be aware, but also gets us ready for whatever actions are necessary. Let me summarize what we heard from God's word before we close. With respect to the rule of government, God gave its authority, which is why we need to submit ourselves to it as faithful followers of Christ. With the role of government, God made it as an agent to protect and preserve the common good. The government is not perfect. No government is, because no human being is perfect, which explains the conflict we have with God's agency. In terms of our responsibility to the government, as Christians, we are commanded to submit to its authority only as far as when being good citizens will make us bad Christians. We should be good citizens until being good citizens make us bad Christians. That's where we draw the line. This calls for compliance and vigilance on our part, continuously watching out for and having the true biblical wisdom on when government infringes on the way we honor God. When it does, we need to follow Peter's vocal stand that we ought to obey God rather than men. I don't have to tell you that all levels of governments everywhere are frail and failing because of humanity's sinfulness and corruption. You're seeing it everywhere. But God has brought someone to bear and turn us all from corruption to redemption, his son Jesus Christ. What we read in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 to 7 is much more than a prophecy, but a promise. God will bring forth a government, one to rule and reign under the ultimate leadership of Christ. We read in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of all the titles proclaimed here, one that's implied in the first part of the verse is that Christ will be the one to bring that perfect government, one that he will carry by his own. As a result, he deserves the title of King of Kings because he will be ruler of all and will rule for all time. In verse 7, it follows, of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. In other words, we can faithfully submit to today's governments because Christ has brought them all under his authority, both now and forever. To close our time today, let me bring you to a significant response Jesus makes in light of what we have been talking about today. When confronted by his detractors in order to trap him, they issued a question about the paying of taxes. Let's look at his response in Luke chapter 20, verses 24 to 25. Show me a denarius. Whose image and inscription are on it? Caesar's, they replied. He said to them, then give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. Jesus' answer should direct our hearts and minds to something a lot more critical to understand. The coin he pointed out to bore the image of the one who is an authority in the civil government of his time. In creation, however, all of us, whether you follow Christ or not, bear the image of our Creator. As Christ asks that you render or give back or submit to the image inscribed on the coin, we are all to submit and surrender to the image of the one who created us. That's the submission and surrender we all need to begin with in the first place, having faith and acknowledging the ultimate authority in the one whose image we bear. Christ surrendered and sacrificed himself on the cross to redeem God's image in us and to restore us to that rightful place of blessing under God's loving rule he intended us to be from the very beginning. I invite you all to pray as we consider what we heard from today's word. Lord Jesus, you said that you've given us peace that passes all understanding, a peace that we may not be able to explain, but one that we can experience. Lord, direct us to experience this peace in you as Lord and Savior. We need this kind of peace because none can put our souls at rest in the midst of what's happening in the world. Call us to vigilance in prayer and call us for the awareness and readiness to respond in action when necessary. Teach us the wisdom to do so as we live in worship in you, who will bear and bring that perfect government to rule for all eternity. We pursue and proclaim this in the preaching, teaching, and living out your word before the world so that they may know you and give their lives over to you. Amen.